Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we are going to paint a fruity slushy drink for Sketchbook Sunday, and I'm using gouache today. I have started off with a mechanical pencil, and I am just sketching the jar in my Fabriano Venice Book Sketchbook, and that's the sketchbook I've been using for every Sketchbook Sunday video thus far. And basically, it's kind of like a mason jar type of jar with kind of like flat little like flutes on the side, so I was just trying to get that. And I flip my sketchbook upside down whenever I'm doing something symmetrical, and I'm having a hard time getting both edges to match. I've learned that taking a little extra time with my drawing really makes a difference when I go to paint it. If you take an extra 5 minutes in your drawing, that's going to save you about 20 minutes when you go to paint, because you're not going to have to correct and mess around with it quite so much. And I do flip my sketchbook around several times during the process of drawing, just to make sure I've got my proportions right, my lips right, and I've got my edges straight. It's really easy to get a little crooked and not realize it when you're sitting at your table sketching, because you may have a little bit of a perspective skew go on if you're sitting up straight and your book is lying flat. So it just helps to, you know, look at it with fresh eyes. You can also do that by taking a break and coming back to it, or looking at your picture in a mirror, or something one of my students does is takes a photo of their sketch and then looks at it because they can figure out where they've gone wrong by looking at their photo better than they can looking at their drawing. So any of those tips can really help if you are undecided on whether your picture is correct or not. So the photo that I'm working from is from the website Unsplash, which is a great repository of photos that you can use for your paintings, and I will link it up below so you can go check it out and check out the work of the photographer that took this picture. Because you can always look at photographer galleries too, which is another wonderful way to find some great reference material. There was a couple slices of lemon on the table in this illustration or in this photograph, and I thought that looked really nice, so to balance out my picture I added those in. And now I'm just cleaning up any stray lines with my kneaded eraser and getting ready to paint. Today I'm using gouache paint. I really felt opaque like acrylics, but it's also reworkable like watercolor, so it's kind of the best of both worlds for me. I'm not a huge fan of using acrylics. I do from time to time, just because I might be using something large or I need something that's going to dry permanent, but for the most part I don't really get into the flow too easily with acrylics. But with gouache, for whatever reason, I just find it to be such an intuitive medium, and I absolutely love it. The other thing I really love about gouache paint is that there's not a huge difference between really expensive artists grade gouache paint and lesser expensive gouache paint. Like the stuff I'm using right now is Arteza gouache, and a set of 24 is under 20 bucks, or at least it was last time I checked on Amazon. And I really find the quality to be really nice. The colors mix well, which sometimes you have an issue with cheaper paints, that they don't like to mix very well together, or they get really muddy or chalky easily. But I didn't find that to be the case with this gouache, and quite frankly, with most cheap gouaches I've used, I've found them to be just fine. So I'll be using a variety of colors. I'm using a kind of like a magenta rose pink color. I'm using ultramarine blue, lemon yellow, burnt sienna, and white. And I did add crimson red in towards the end. I was considering starting off with that color, but I thought the magenta was going to give me a large enough range, but I really needed that crisp red, so I'll add that in later. So basically I'm mixing all my colors here, and I really find that they mix really well, and I love the way they go on this sketchbook paper. You're not going to use as much water when you use gouache, so if you have a paper that has been either rippling a lot with your sketchbook work or it's been pilling a lot, you're going to find that gouache is a lot easier to work with. You can also use poster paint or tempera paint. They're all very similar to gouache. I find that when I buy a tube of gouache, though, it's much more concentrated than like a poster paint or a tempera paint, although they are pretty much the same animal, meaning an opaque watercolor. Because gouache is reworkable, I start by blocking in color, kind of like I would if I was oil painting. I find it a great bridge medium to go towards oils or acrylics. If you're a watercolor painter, it's just a wonderful medium to get you ready for those mediums, although in and of itself, it's really just a wonderful paint to work with. Since I'm in a sketchbook, I don't have to worry about fading, which is something that gouache is kind of known for, its ability to fade, or ability, its tendency to fade, although these are Arteza gouaches have pretty good light fast ratings for what it's worth. I haven't put it to the test myself, but they do offer light fast information and pigment information on the tubes. I feel like when I work with gouache, I can be so free because anything I do, I can undo. Anything I do, I can paint over. The colors are opaque, which means I can layer it if I use a gentle touch, or I can completely mix into what I have down below if I want to have some blending. When I set out to do this illustration, I was kind of thinking that I might want to do it with alcohol markers, but the paper in this sketchbook is not really designed for alcohol markers, so I decided I do want to keep all my Sketchbook Sunday videos in this from this book because I think it'll be fun, like in a year, to flip through the book and see what I've done. Maybe I've improved. That would be really cool to see. So I decided I would use gouache, and plus with gouache I have a lot more ability to rework it, like I mentioned before, versus using markers where you kind of have to put it down where you want it because it's really difficult to erase it and redo. Another thing that brings me a lot of joy, which is probably going to sound really silly, is mixing on a ceramic palette, and this could be a white dinner plate. This is a ceramic flower palette that I found online. I just really like mixing on ceramic, white ceramic, because I can see my colors really well. They don't bead up, and it's just really easy to lift it back up again. I love that I can make a variety of grays and neutrals using the colors that I've already used, and the paint is just so easy to lift up and keep working from. Now, the little containers that my paints are in, I did a video on this a few weeks ago. I took a set of 24 plastic containers from Harbor Freight. The box was under $5, and I emptied out my Arteza gouache into those little boxes. And then I took the labels, and you have to do this before you squeeze all the paint out. I'll warn you, you can peel the labels off of the Arteza paints and stick them right to the edges of the boxes, and then you can see exactly what color you have and what the light fast rating is, which is really awesome. So there you can see where I grabbed the crimson red paint just because I felt like this, I think it's probably like a raspberry slushy type of drink. I felt like I just really needed that crisp red that I wasn't able to get by mixing my magenta and yellow. The brushes I've been using throughout this piece are the Zen All Media brushes by Royal and Langnickel, and there's a couple features I really like about these brushes. For one, they're not very expensive. You can buy them individually at most big box craft stores or in sets online, and in a lot of big box craft stores you can get the sets. But the All Media ones are excellent in gouache. They're also really good for acrylics. But another good thing about gouache is that you can just rinse them in your water and put them away. You don't have to wash them with soap and water unless you've gotten them really, really filled up with paint. I try to keep my paint on the tips of the bristles, and that really saves a lot of wear and tear on my brush. You never want to get the paint up into the metal part that holds the bristles. That's called the ferrule. Once the paint gets up there, then it can be really difficult to remove, and then your bristles don't stay nice and sharp together. But I'm a big fan of Royal and Langnickel brushes, and these Zen All Media ones are excellent for gouache. I also like that they feature an acrylic handle, so if I forget and leave them soaking in my water overnight, they're not going to swell and become loose. So, another bonus of having an acrylic handled brush. When I'm working with gouache, I tend to get kind of big and bold and then refine as I go. So my first step, of course, is blocking in, and then I try to get some shadows and highlights. And now I'm kind of working on some of the details, like dabbing in white and red for where I want the kind of crystals of slushy ice in the water. That little thing that looks kind of like a flame at the top of the drink, I think it's like maybe like a vanilla bean or something. It looks like some sort of organic root. So I'm assuming it's probably like a vanilla bean that's been like dried and mashed to just kind of stuck in there. I'm using some watered down, really pale paint to add that kind of reflected highlight on the flat facets of the jar. And I'm also throwing in a little bit of cast reflection and where you can kind of see different tones in the drink through the vase. And I'm also dabbing on some yellow that are reflected from the lemon slices that are on the table. So you want to pay attention to all those little nuances when you are creating. Gouache can be used thinned down like a watercolor, but it can also be used full strength like an acrylic. And that's what I'm doing here by picking up full strength white and adding the really crisp highlights on the jar. That gives it that sparkle and gives it that extra layer of whiteness that kind of helps you fill that whole value spectrum of colors. So the nice thing about this versus watercolor, which I absolutely love watercolor, but the thing that I love about this is that I do not have to plan. I can just kind of go with the flow, and I can still put in highlights at the end. I don't have to reserve them. I can go in and add more, layer on more shadows. I can layer on more detail. I can refine as I go, and I don't have to plan in advance, which is wonderful for your sketchbook because you can seriously just sit down, play, have fun, and go with the flow. And I just can't say enough about gouache. I think it's such a special medium. A cool thing about gouache is that if I didn't finish up this painting in one setting, I could save that palette and come back to it and re-wet any of those colors on my palette and they would be fine, as opposed to acrylic, which would dry permanently and you'd have to squeeze out fresh colors. So like I mentioned, they're very much like watercolor, but the reason I keep them in these little individual pots with lids on them as opposed to putting them in a watercolor palette is because gouache has a tendency to kind of shrink up as it dries, and those little pieces can break apart and make a big mess in your palette and get all mixed up and become unusable. So by putting them in little pots with their own covers, it just saves the paint. So if it dries out and becomes like a loose bunch of shards, all I got to do is spritz it with water and it's ready to go again. But if I had them in one big open palette and that happened, they'd all get mixed up, all those little shards, and I wouldn't be able to save the paint. So that's why I do that, and I do explain that a little bit more when I have my palette video, if you want to go back and find that. I'll try to remember to link that in the video description for your convenience. And we're pretty much coming to the end of this demonstration. I like to go through and add my brightest highlights again, add little dabs of white for sparkle, maybe go in with some mixed gray for any like crisp shadows under like the threads on the lip of the jar, but it's pretty much done. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please give me a thumbs up if so, and we'll see you next week for another Sketchbook Sunday video. Thanks for watching. Until next time, happy crafting.